The routines file contains basically dot has the name server p.root, and dot as in root has the name server q.root and r.root. Those are the names of the three root name servers. And we also have address information for them. So p.root has the address 10.0.0.17. So that's what we need here. The next thing is that we need to make unbound, well, we need to set up unbound command channel authentication.
Canal de comando de unbound.
So what is that?
¿Y qué es eso?
Well, if we go back here and we look at the unbound configuration here, it says after you install it, that's that part, we also need to configure authentication. And that's this part, unbound control setup. So let's do that. Unbound control setup. And this generates keys and certificates and things that are being used to control the running name server. And now you see there's a bunch of new files here with certificate stuff, etc. So that's just taken care of, all done. After that, root.hints is done. There is a configuration file called unbound.conf, and we need to take a look at that and see that it uses the right root.hints file. And we should look at interface attributes for the IP addresses, and we should look at access control. Okay. So here we have the configuration file for unbound. It says that all the configuration stuff is in this directory. It should listen on this v4 address, which is the v4 address of this server, according to that table that I showed you some hour ago. This v6 address, v4 localhost, v6 localhost. So queries that arrive to any of these four IP addresses, unbound will deal with. So that's fine. And then we have access control relaxed. So that means we will respond to queries from anyone. Not a good thing on the public internet, because you will be used as a reflector in a DDoS attack somehow. Don't do that. But here in the lab environment, it's fine. Assuming, of course, that your fellow students are not bad people that engage in DDoS attacks in the lab environment. And now it should be all set. So unbound control start, that's how you start the name server. Oh, no complaints. Unbound control status. Yeah, it seems to be fairly happy. Does it work? Well, how do you test that the name server is working? Well, any suggestions? Dig? As in, you send a query to it and see whether it manages to respond. So dig, where should we send the query? Well, we should send it, obviously, to one of these four IP addresses. Which one is the best one to send the query to? No, it doesn't depend. It's always the same answer. The shortest one to type. That is the correct answer. So the obvious thing is to use ::1, because it's both short and easy to type. Dig at ::1, and we want to query for something. Now, in this lab environment, we don't have the entire public namespace. We only have the lab stuff. But the lab stuff is still a root. There is a TLD called DNS lab, and all of you guys would be underneath DNS lab, as in alpha.dns lab and bravo.dns lab, etc. And then we have the ARPA tree, as on the public internet, etc. So we can query for stuff. Let's see, ARPA NS. This means I'm asking for the name servers of the zone ARPA. And the answer is, ARPA has three name servers, p.root, q.root, and r.root. And we also get some GLUE information that they have the following addresses. Okay, so that's slightly surprising, actually, because as you see, those are not the same addresses that we have in the root hints file. Suddenly there is v6 information also. Okay, so what if I query for r.root quad A? Yeah, apparently r.root has a v6 address, which is not in the root hints file, because here we only had v4 addresses. And this is because Unbound is a recursive name server. It doesn't just tell you stuff that was in a configuration file or in the root hints file. It looks things up. And on the publishing side, these servers have v6 addresses. It's just that I didn't force you to type those in. But it will find them out automatically by querying for stuff, and it will learn as it goes along. So we could query for the ARPA stuff. What can we query for anything else? Well, we can query for ..dnslab.a, for instance. So the web server here has the IP address 10.0.0.1. Basically, it seems to work. If I query for something that doesn't exist, that one doesn't exist, I hope, I will get a so-called NX domain back. So now I'm looking up here in the header of the packet. This is actually a description of the entire DNS message. It has a header with flag bits in the beginning, it has a query section, it has an answer section, authority, and additional. And here we have the header part. And we see flag bits, and we see that the status is NX domain, and we see other stuff. We have the query part. This is the question that was asked. We don't have an answer part, and the reason we don't have an answer part is because there is no answer. But I told you that the authority section is always there, and it will have different interpretations depending on the situation. And in the case of a so-called negative answer, when it says this thing you're asking about doesn't exist, then the authority section will carry the so-called SOA record of the zone in which the answer should have been found had it existed, but it didn't. So it's basically a proof of having looked in the right place. But it's still a non-existent domain name, so it doesn't exist. And the difference, if I ask for something that did exist, then, as you see up here, the status is no error. So different status depending on what happens or doesn't happen. And you can play around like this with DIG for a long time and basically knock yourself out. But sooner or later you will tire of it, and we will continue. So I would like to see you get your name servers installed. I believe most of you have that already. I would like to see you create that authentication stuff with unbound control setup, this part. And I would like to see you start your name servers and verify that they work. The last piece here, the only piece I haven't shown you so far, is that if we follow along in the instructions, you see that, here's a typo. That stuff should be on two lines. That allow should not be, that access control should be on the next line. So it's an error. Down here we have the so-called stub resolver configuration. So what is the stub resolver configuration? It's something that tells your laptop or your phone or whatever where to send DNS queries, as in where is the recursive server located. And the format of that file is the string name server followed by the IP address of the name server. So here I've said that use the recursive name server located on IP address ::1 as in localhost. So all the examples I showed you here, like dig at whatever, I could actually take out this part. If I don't specify which name server I will send the query to, then dig will look in the resolve.conf file, and as you see down here, it used ::1. So it looks for the resolver configuration and uses that IP address to send the query to, unless you specify something else. And further on, we will need to be able to specify something else, because, for instance, we want to send queries to our authoritative server, or we want to send a query to someone else's server, etc. And then you need this at sign notation. But for now, we're done. So my suggestion is that you do this as quickly as possible after I've stopped describing configuration of the authoritative server, which is the next step. So if we look at that here, we get to configuration of the authoritative server. And the plan here is that your master server will be a hidden master, so there will not be any NS records for the master. The slave will be a public name server, so there will be an NS record for the slave. And you should set up zone transfers between the master and the slave. And if I haven't stumbled on the keyboard, all of this should actually be more or less prepared for you. So let's take a look. I log into my, could that be it? Yep. Here is my master server for the Whiskey Lab group. I need a name server, so I install NSD. I go to the configuration directory of NSD and I find various zone files and things. Here is the Whiskey zone file. And how many people here have never ever seen a zone file? Everyone has seen a zone file. Excellent. Everyone here knows what the SOA record is? Excellent. So how many SOA records do we have in a zone? One. Good. So here we have the Whiskey zone file, and as you can see here, Whiskey has exactly one NS record, ns.whiskey.dnslab. And ns.whiskey.dnslab has two IP addresses, 10.0.23.1 and some V6 stuff. That's the IP addresses of the slave, not of the master. So the master is a hidden master. Okay, let's set this up. NSD control setup. Generate certificates. NSD control start. Seems to be working. NSD control status. Seems happy. You can also do things like zone status. And then it will tell you basically the state of each zone that it is authoritative for. So as you can see here, this server is authoritative for whiskey.dnslab. And it has sent notifies to the slave, and it is the master. But it's also authoritative for these two zones, 2310 in adder ARPA and some horrible thing, ip6.arpa. Do you know what those things are? That's correct. It's the v6 reverse and the v4 reverse. So In the lab topology, each group has a V4 prefix, which is 10.groupNumber/16. So if I'm group 23, that means that 10.23/16 is my reverse zone, and I will populate that with stuff. And same thing in the V6 case. So all those three zones are running, and notifiers have been sent to the slave, and the slave is completely asleep, so we need to set the slave up.
LACNIC proxy axfernet p.
Six thousand is the slave, correct? The master is on port 5000. So 5000 is master, 6 is slave, and 7 is recursive server. So here we are on the slave, and the slave doesn't have any name server, so we install that pkg add nsd, and then we take a look at the configuration. And here we don't have any zone files, as you can see. So we need NSD control set up to generate the certificates and stuff. And after that, we take a look at NSD.conf to see how this name server is configured. So the slave is configured to listen on two V4 addresses and two V6 addresses and V6 localhost. So why are there two? Well, that's because the slave has one external interface to the outside. Do you see this? So this is to the outside, and that is to the inside. So on the inside, the IP address will be 10.groupNumber01. Let's check. So we have that 10.groupNumber01. That's the inside address. And the outside address is 10.0groupNumber1. And we have that also, 10.0groupNumber1. So that's basically listen on the inside and the outside V4 interfaces, listen on the inside and outside V6 interfaces, and listen on localhost. Sorry? That's an interesting question. So when it comes to security, my preference is to say I consider DNS data to be public, so I basically open my master up for public zone transfer from whomever. If you want it, you can have it. So that said, not everyone has the same view. So if you want to have more control over zone transfers, and if you want to be able to restrict zone transfers so that only your slave is able to transfer the zone, etc., somehow you need to arrange for this restriction to do what you want. There are basically two ways of doing this. Alternative number one, restrict zone transfers by IP address. So the master will allow outbound zone transfers to whomever who sends a zone transfer request from the right address, as in the slave server address, for instance. This is a bad design. Don't do that. The other alternative is to allow zone transfers based on some sort of digital signature proving the authenticity of the other party. This is called TSIG, transaction signatures. That's a good design. So I basically don't care about the IP address of the slave. I don't care whether it goes to the inside interface, the outside interface, or whatever. I only care about the zone transfer request being signed by a secret key that we have agreed upon. So, and just to give you one example why this is sort of important. So at NetNode, I'm sort of responsible for something like 300 name servers spread around the world. We have customers all around the world. Nick Chile is a customer of mine. So Nick Chile sends the zone transfer of the .cl zone from their master in Santiago to our distribution infrastructure. And then we send it from our distribution infrastructure out to all our public name servers all around the planet. So what is the IP address that the zone transfer request to Chile is coming from? Well, it's coming from something hidden inside NetNode. It's not coming from the slave IP address, because the slaves are out there spread around, and they are Anycast and all that stuff. So as long as we use tsig, NetNode is able to enhance and modify and strengthen our distribution infrastructure in various clever ways without every time having to change all the interaction with every customer. But if we use IP address access control based things, it will break whenever. And it's possible to get it to work rather easily, but if you have a large customer base and you have hundreds of name servers and you have lots of infrastructure, it's a nightmare to maintain. So tsig is more secure, more flexible, and less error prone. Just do tsig. That said, tsig is usually part of this course, so you would have been doing lab exercises on tsig, but we had to rip stuff out to have enough time for the DNSSEC parts. Okay? So, moving on. We have the server configuration up here with IP addresses. We have the remote control stuff, just like we had in Unbound. And then we get to the actual zone configurations. And here you see something, and I don't know whether Barry got to that. Did you get to patterns? No. Then it's further on in the slides. They are, but they're further on. So there are so many slides. So pattern is a clever mechanism in NSD to create templates, to avoid specifying the same thing over and over again. So for instance, if I'm a slave server and I'm slaving three zones from the same master, not having to specify the same tsig key every time, the same IP address to fetch from every time, etc., all those things that are similar for all these three zone configurations, I can put in a template and call that a pattern. So that's what we're doing here. We're saying that we have a pattern and the pattern has a name, slave. I can have multiple patterns with different structure, etc. It says request zone transfer from, and this is the IP, this is the V4 address of my master server, my hidden master. I should allow notifies that come from my hidden master. And I should provide zone transfers to everyone and their dog, because here we keep it open. Mostly that is for debugging purposes. It's easier to verify the stuff works when you can try zone transfers, etc. And then I configure each zone. So the whiskey zone has the zone file whiskey.dnslab, and then it just says include pattern slave, which is a referral to this part. And it will basically just copy this stuff down here. So it's a shorter, tighter configuration. And when I change to a different master, I only update this part, and all my 300 zones will automatically do the right thing, etc. So this is not unique to NSD in any way. Templating exists in all sorts of configuration environments, but it's very useful. So we use that. So here you go. This is the configuration. And if we start it up, what happens? Well, to begin with, we have control state a happy name server. What is the status of the zones? Apparently, we are serving three zones here. We're serving the v4 reverse, the v6 reverse, and the whiskey.dnslab zone, just like the master does. So we have fetched them successfully from the master, and everything is working fine. How come we're not seeing any zone files? That's because NSD doesn't write out the zone file automatically, because that's a performance issue. Writing to the disk costs performance. Well, how much of a problem could it be, really? Well, trust me, it can be a lot of problem. Another zone that I'm serving is .eu. So I'm giving away all the corporate secrets here. .eu is a fairly large zone. It has 5 million delegations. .eu is updated once every 5 seconds. So if I'm writing a file with 5 million delegations in it, which is something like 500-600 megabytes of stuff, every 5 seconds I will just kill my disk, and it will cost me a lot of performance. So NSD writes out zone files on request, but not all the time. So if I want to have them on disk for some reason, I can have a cron job or something that writes them to disk once an hour or something. But that's the reason why we're not seeing them. So everything is working fine. And that brings us back to this. Ta-ta-ta, port number, preparing the hidden master, zone contents, configuration of the master server, nsd.conf, start, check for error messages, and we've actually done all of this stuff. So everything looks fine here. The last part, and we've already done all of this stuff, the last part is that we would like to see a delegation from the parent. If you don't have a delegation from the parent, you basically don't exist. So we know now that this server, dig at that box, whiskey.dnslab, oops, that zone obviously exists, and you can query for the SOA record, etc. But if we go to the recursive server and we query for whiskey.dnslab SOA, what happens then is that you get a confused teacher. Well, I think it's more a question of automatically setting up the delegations to give you guys less to do. Apparently, the delegation is there. So dig. So we can look at the delegation. Dig DNS lab NS. Those are the name servers for DNS lab. Dig at ns1.dnslab, whiskey.dnslab SOA. So, note here that I queried for the SOA record for whiskey, but I sent the query to the authoritative server for the parent, for DNS lab. What did I get back? Did I get back the answer? No. Are you good with me not getting the answer back? You understand why? Good. So I just got the referral back. So this is the referral. The name server for whiskey is ns.whiskey, and here are the addresses. So obviously the delegation is in place. And if I query for something else, like alpha, that's also in place. So all of them are in place, which is good, because then it's less work. So this doesn't have to be done. And then you should just verify that you can, well, query for stuff, and that's what we did. So I would like you to get your recursive server configuration done, your authoritative server configuration done, both the hidden master and the slave, just like I've shown you here. And hopefully it shouldn't take too long, because as you've seen, I haven't done any configuration work. It's just a question of installing name servers, setting up certificates, starting them up, and it will just work. Okay? Because we need to get towards the DNSSEC part as quickly as possible.
Cloud. Well, the network problems are being sorted out. I'd like to continue a bit about the explanation, what we're doing. The security in DNS, why is it necessary? Let us look a bit in the DNS transactions going. I'm not too happy with the word transactions. We've got this own data, which is being served, given to the master data, which sends it out to the slave serves, which can be queried by the clients. So there are recursive name servers, which will contact one of the client, one of the slave servers, which in turn are being used with stub reserve resolvers in order to find out where the machines are on the internet. Now this zone data is not always static. Updates are being sent from here the cold host, updates to the zone file. Now if we look where transactions are taking place, well, the transactions are being taken place as dynamic updates from these hosts to the master server, which update the zone data. The zone data itself, of course, is being updated, which is a file or through another XFR transfer. The master server will send its zone file to the slave servers. So there are also transactions, the zone transfers taking place here. Recursive name servers out on the internet will perform queries to the slave servers, so there are transactions there. And the stub resolvers, in turn, also do their queries to the recursive name servers. Where can problems arise, security-wise? Well, everywhere. I could load wrong zone data in there. There could be an impersonated master on there, so not a real master server, but some other machine out there that imposes itself as the master server and loads the wrong data to one of the slave servers. Something we'll get around to is cache pollution taking place here between the queries sent out by the recursive name servers and the slave servers answering them. And updates could be also be impersonated. I'll skip this one. If you want to make a categorization, then we can't say that one part can be solved using server security by letting only certain machines do the updates by IP address limitation, or rather by TSIG, so signatures that have to be valid. But there's another class of problems in security-wise, and that is actually the machines that are not under your control of the zone, which also perform transactions, DNS transactions, which could have the wrong data. A small sidestep, and that's the DNS extension. I only want to touch on it briefly, but the DNS protocol is very old. It's bit-based. There's no room in there. There has been talk of using TCP and large UDP packets. It all doesn't really work, so some other ugly extension EDNS has been thought of in order to give more room to the queries to have larger answers, because we do need these larger answers when trying to secure things. What's this? I'll skip this. There's just a bit in there that says there is an extension. The extension should be supported, but is now generally supported by modern name service. Now, if it comes to data protection, so protecting the zone data, not protecting the transfers between servers that are under your control, but protecting the data once it gets out of your hands, this is where DNSSEC comes in. So let's dive in a bit. A client sends out a request to its stub resolver, to recursive name server resolvers. They'll recurse down the network to find an answer and ending up at the authoritative name server. Authoritative, it has the definite answer. And then the answer can be propagated back through the recursive name servers to get it back. The problem lies in that path over there. There's no secure connection anywhere. And even if it would be secure, there's no way of telling who is actually on the other end. It can be intercepted. It's plain data, plain text, no encryption. Cannot be a real encryption there and there. And there could be an evil eddy out there that intercepts these queries. And once it intercepts these queries, the server might send something back, but evil eddy can also send something back. And it might block the actual server, but it doesn't even need to block it. It only needs to be there first. And then you're done. Evil eddy can send back a fignated response. And then even though you're using HTTPS, serving to whatever safe website outside there, you're lost because you got a wrong IP number. The certificate of that site might be fine, but it is wrong web server out there, or whatever service you're using. This is for intercepting. There's another possibility for things to go wrong, and that is if one of the resolvers actually got the wrong data in its cache. It should go ask this recursive resolver, but somehow it has been faked, duped into going to a different wrong resolver that has been under the control of evil eddy. And then you don't even need to be faster than the actual server because it will never get there. And this is where the cache pollution comes in. You're able to send false data to these recursive name servers where you can steal someone's website, SSH server, or whatever. So this last thing about trying to trick one of these recursive name servers, that's called cache pollution. These recursive name servers, in order to gain some kind of speed, otherwise things would break down, all have their caches of cached responses. And if they know it should go there, then they'll remember this for next query so that if another client asks for the question, it can just respond the answer without needing to contact the other resolver. How does cache pollution work? Well, I'll just keep it global. But the DNS protocol allows for sending additional information. So you ask for a certain query, you get back the response, but you also get some other information that the server thinks that might be useful for you. This to speed up the DNS protocol, and sometimes it's necessary in case of glue information. So this additional information in the additional section can be sent out, can be used to send useful items for your query. But it does not need to be related to your actual query. You can send any data back. Bad design, but it's part of the DNS protocol. And basically, by sending back data relating to the fake site, you can inject different data in the cache of the recursive resolver that you trying to hijack. So, well, sure, there are bad guys out there, but yeah. So this have to look. The whole purpose of DNSSEC was to be also be and not break the existing protocol. Existing protocol should remain as is, only if some recursive resolver and stub resolver and alternative servers are aware of the DNSSEC, then they should use it. So in that sense, it's voluntary. And the whole idea was to be able to phase it in. How successful was it that it's still much on the way, even though it's a decade old? Two decades even. I don't even know. Before my time.
It's 21 years since I taught my first DNSSEC course.
But I have a nice website, and the uptake of DNSSEC is still taking place, but still slow. And last week, it became mandatory for websites from the Dutch government to enable DNSSEC. But this only happened last week that it became mandatory. And this is for where you put your tax returns in, not secured. So what is the whole problem with DNSSEC, with DNS, is that you have some answer, but the answer could be fake or not. So some way you're gonna, the recursive resolvers and your stub resolver need to be able to tell, is this the wrong data or is this the right data? And this is basically what DNSSEC does. I'm not going to follow the slide because I don't know by heart. It adds a proof of whether the data is being sent is valid or not. Yeah. Do I need to do the Kaminsky attack?
Sorry?
I think I'm going to...
Do you want me to do that?
Yeah, please.
I can do that.
I know it in global terms, but...
So... Once upon a time, there was a bunch of geeks, and the geeks
the geeks, we thought that DNSSEC was the right thing to do because we needed to secure the DNS system. The problem was that the world wasn't really listening, so it was just us running around saying we need to do DNSSEC, and the rest of the world said, "Sure, you play with your stuff, and we will do the real thing." And then the Kaminsky attack came. And the thing with the Kaminsky attack was that do any of you either remember or know about the Kaminsky attack beforehand, or is this news to you? A little bit, yeah. So Dan Kaminsky, he figured out a way of drastically improving the efficiency of so-called spoofing attacks. So what is a spoofing attack? Well, a spoofing attack is, I remember I had an iPad once. There it is. A spoofing attack is where you you query a recursive name server for something, and you know when the query is being issued. So you have your helper here on the inside. This is, for instance, the ISP recursive name server, and this is someone inside the ISP network, and he asks for, what do I know, www.bank.com. And because you are working together, this guy, he knows, oh sorry, that guy, the attacker, he knows that immediately when the query is issued from the inside, we will start bombarding the recursive server with forged answers for this thing, claiming that www.bank.com has some other IP address. So what are the odds of us getting our forged answer in before the real answer comes in? Well, we have basically a window of milliseconds. But that's not the only thing. We also have other things that we need to get right. For instance, there are port numbers that you need to get right, because there is a port number associated with the query. And in the end, the odds of the bad guy winning are fairly low. So what happens then? The helper on the inside, he issues the query for www.bank.com. We start bombarding him with forged answers, but in the end we lose, and the good guys win because they have everything right, the port number and address and everything. And the answer is cached. That means that we have a new chance first when the stuff has expired from the cache. And let's assume that it stays in the cache for, let's say, two days. That means if we have a rather low chance of winning, us being the bad guys, it's more fun being the bad guy, but never mind. So us being the bad guys, we have a fairly low chance of winning this contest of getting the forged answer in before the real answer arrives. And typically we lose, and then we get another chance 2 days later, and typically we lose. So if we are really, really persistent, we will win in the end, but it can take months until we actually get there. So it's possible to spoof stuff into a standard recursive server, but it's not easy. You really have to be persistent. The thing that changed with the Kaminsky attack was the efficiency, because he figured out a way of defeating this hold down period based on the caching. So how does it work? Well, it works this way. The attacker, he doesn't query about www.bank.com. Instead, he queries for something random, .bank.com. And we can be fairly sure that something random, .bank.com, is not in the cache. So we can be fairly sure that there will be an outbound query here for something random, .bank.com, going to bank.com name servers. So we have the same attack window as before, and we can start sending in all those forged answers, just like before. The odds are as bad as before, and the good guys win, and they say, no, there is no such thing as randomstring.bank.com. The difference is that suddenly we can just issue a new attack. We query for something other random, and we can just keep on going. And these attacks can be 5 milliseconds apart, and we just speed up the intensity of the attack. Okay, so that means that in a fairly short time, we're able to convince the recursive server that randomstring.bank.com has a certain IP address. I mean, that's absolutely a feat and something to be proud of, being bad guys, but is it really useful? And that's the kicker, because if you look at the DNS protocol, you have something called the glue record. And the glue record is something that travels together with the delegation information. So if you're querying for something and the response you get back is that you should go and talk to this name server, which by the way has the following IP address, then you will look at that IP address and you will send the next query to that IP address. Because if you have a name server that is in Bailiwick, that's the only way of getting to it. So the response here is an answer section which says random string has the following address. Random string has the name server, www.bank.com or net, never mind. So this is obviously fake. This is also fake, claiming that this is not, this is a point of delegation. There is a new zone below this node in the tree. And this new zone has that as the name server. It's all a lie. And suddenly, in the additional section, we haven't spoken much about the additional section here, but the additional section is conceptually, in the answer section, you have answers to the query issued. In the authority section, you have proofs for why you should, well, trust the answer. In the additional section, you have random cruft, which are answers to questions you haven't asked. I mean, if I need to go, I need to follow a delegation and I should talk to the name server foo.bar, and in the additional section I get foo.bar has the IP address, whatever. Yes, I need that information, but it's still the answer to a question I haven't asked. So the additional section is no end of problems because it contains dangerous information that the recursive server hasn't asked about. But in some cases, you have to look at that, in particular in the case of glue information. So if we have a delegation here and the name server has the name www.bank.net, then in the additional section, we have glue for www.bank.net saying this is the IP address of the name server. And that is something the recursive server will look at. So the random string here is not the victory. The random string is sort of just the nose of the camel. The rest of the camel is the stuff that follows behind, and that's where the problem arises. So if you can run the attack over and over again, a few milliseconds apart, instead of a few days apart, obviously the efficiency of that attack increases. So how efficient did it get? Well, a friend of mine, an English guy, he wrote a very, very nice, well, app, you would say today, a window application, with a text field where you could put in name that I want to spoof into the cache of the recursive server, and then IP address of recursive server. And then there was a giant button which said spoof, and you push the button and the clock starts running. And he didn't give me the source, unfortunately. I'm not sure why. It could be that he doesn't trust me. But still, I've seen this run in demonstration context after the Kaminsky attack on public recursive servers of major ISPs. And he pushed the spoof button. And 2-3 minutes later, a record of our choice is accepted by that recursive server. So that's obviously a major problem. And because of that being a major problem, suddenly DNSSEC started gaining traction. Suddenly it stopped being a computer science project by geeks like me and a few others, and it turned into something that was really important to others. So this is basically why we're here now, because before the Kaminsky attack, how many signed TLDs did we have on the network? One. Sweden. Has nothing to do with me. Pure coincidence. But still, it was just one. How many signed TLDs do we have now? I think it's something like 70% of them. Perhaps even higher numbers, because all the new DTLDs that I can keep throwing out, they are signed, all of them, because that's a requirement. So very, very quickly, the penetration ratio of TLDs is growing. So today, DNSSEC is more or less a done thing in the TLD space. So did we have the root signed when the Kaminsky attack happened? No. Had we been talking to ICANN for years and years and years about the importance of signing the root? Yes, we had. Had ICANN listened? No, they hadn't. But suddenly, after the Kaminsky attack, they started listening. So it really doesn't matter much to us exactly which type of attack this was and how it works. The important thing is that there is an attack. we have no other long-term solution than actually signing the DNS infrastructure, the DNS hierarchy. And everyone who examines the problem comes to the same conclusion, which is why the root is signed, which is why all the TLDs are signed, which is why we are seeing more and more DNSSEC penetration also further down. I'm not saying that DNSSEC has won the war. I'm not saying that most of the zones in the world are signed, because they're not. But over time, it is happening. In Sweden, all the ISPs are doing DNSSEC validation. Something like close to 50% of the delegations are signed. I think in the Netherlands, you have even higher numbers than we have when it comes to DNSSEC penetration. In the Czech Republic, a vast majority of everything is signed. In some cases, it's because people realize, oh, this is important and this is cool and I can play with crypto keys, and that's always good, so they sign. But to be fair and honest, in most cases, zones get signed because the DNS hosting provider says, I will just sign all my customers, and the customer doesn't have a clue. But that doesn't really matter. The end result is still that we are doing DNSSEC.
That's a nice idea. What in the Netherlands happened? Which offered a discount on the on the price, says that if your zone got DNSSEC signed, you pay less, and that gained a lot in interest.
Yeah, that always works. So the Swedish Register had a really brilliant idea when they were basically the only game in town when it came to DNSSEC. So they said, security should cost, so we will increase the price for those who have signed delegations. Guys, that will never work. Come on. Oh, it's a brilliant idea. They will pay us more. No, they won't. But they changed, and they also did the discount thing instead, because that works much better. So anyways, so the Kaminsky attack now is mostly history, in the sense that it really doesn't matter. Lunch now or lunch in 5 minutes?
5 minutes.
Yeah, that's fine. That said, when I mentioned this application that could basically spoof an arbitrary record into an arbitrary recursive server in a couple of minutes, it's not quite that bad, because what happened immediately after the Kaminsky attack was that the DNS software implementers, they sort of got together and said, we need a stopgap solution to this, because we cannot just DNSSEC sign the entire world in a weekend. We need something that gives us more time. And the thing they came up with is to use a randomized source port. And that means that if you look at this picture, that what we need to get right here is we need to get in before the right answer comes around, and we also need to get the query ID right. The query ID is a 16-bit entity, so it's 1 in 64k chances of getting it right. So I need to basically have thousands of responses coming in before I win. Adding the randomized source port means that instead of the recursive server issuing queries from port 53, it issues queries from a random port and then expects the response on the same random port. And if we have, well, the port space is also 16 bits, but you don't have all of it. So let's say that you have 10 bits of ports or 12 bits of ports, something. That means that the amount of entropy in the system that we have to make it difficult for the attacker goes from 16 bits to, let's say, 26 bits or something. And that basically increases the time for a successful attack from 3 minutes to a weekend. So you can still do this if you start Friday afternoon after the guys head off for the bar, and it would be done by Monday morning. So it doesn't solve the problem, but it gives people a little bit more time. Another thing which is also important is that all of this is based on massive attacks. We're talking about thousands and tens of thousands and hundreds of thousands of forged responses, really an ocean of packets against the recursive server to get that one forged response in that will win the war. So now and then, people argue that that's really not a problem. Our IDS detection system will take care of this. Or we will detect the increased traffic load and we will investigate. And my answer to that is that in some cases, like the military guys, I trust them. Those are very, very good military guys, especially the Swedish military is very good. And I'm sure they're really focusing on detecting packet streams against the recursive servers rather than shooting at the enemy. So that's fine. However, if you look at the typical target here, it's an ISP recursive server. What is the typical work environment of the technical staff, the system administrators at an ISP? The typical work environment is that they are completely overworked, understaffed, things are breaking right, left, and center, and either you devote hours of time to investigate why do we see more queries, why do we see more packets to our recursive server, or they fix this other burning problem that actually causes customers to complain, or they fix this new feature that the boss is asking for. And in the end, practice shows that if the traffic load to the recursive server goes up, you buy a faster server. That's what you do, because you do not have the time to look at all those packets. You could, in theory, but in practice you don't. So of all the thousands and thousands of ISPs around the world, in most cases, they will not find this. Another thing is that the Kaminsky attack is from 2008. So in 2008, the steady stream traffic was to the recursive server. Take a random Swedish ISP. What is the sustained traffic load to the recursive server? 100,000 queries a second, something. And then comes the Kaminsky attack, and suddenly you see not 100,000, but you see perhaps 200,000. That's a noticeable bump in the traffic level that you could notice if you were looking. Now we're 8 years later, and the sustained traffic is no longer 100,000 queries, it's perhaps 400,000 queries a second. And the bump gets smaller over time. It gets more and more difficult to notice the Kaminsky attack if it occurs, the more background traffic we have all the time. So again, some can probably find this and defend against it, most won't. And that's why we basically have no other solution.